So, how many of you were here yesterday for our first panel? So, quite a few. Okay, let me have some new faces too. We were thinking that we would center this panel around writing and storytelling, but if anybody has any questions about voice acting or anything like that, you know, feel free to ask anything at all. How many of you here enjoy writing, say, fan fiction? Quite a few. How many people are interested in becoming writers of novels and things like that? So we have quite a few people. Okay, cool. Well, I've written a science fiction novel, Dancing with Eternity. It won a nice little award for best debut fiction. And as I've gone around, I've noticed that in a lot of fan fiction, there is a problem with structure and plotting, that sometimes things tend to kind of wander and stuff like that. So I give this little panel that hopefully will help in figuring out how to write a story and create an art form that takes place in time. And you guys know what I mean when I say that? I mean, basically, painting and sculpture takes place in space. Music and writing, stories, theater, movies, all that kind of stuff, even games, take place in time. You start in one place and then you finish up on another second that is later in history. And so this kind of art relies on tension and repose. Now, tension is where you're up high and you have a lot of kinetic energy, and repose is when you're back down low and that kinetic energy has been used up. All right, now, am I making sense there? You understand what that means? So I mean, a good instance of this in storytelling is what they call a cliffhanger. You know, you get to the end of a particular episode, say Game of Thrones, and somebody might die, somebody might fall off a cliff, something bad might happen. We don't know how things are going to turn out, and you have to wait to tune in until next time. That is a point of tension. And then when you find out that they didn't die after all, and they're okay, and all they did was stub their toe, that is a point of repose, right? So, as we approach telling a story, you know, the first thing we should do is figure out who is going to populate our story, because many writers have said that good characters are much more important than a good plot. If you have good characters, you can have a really boring plot, and we'll just have fun and be interested in spending time with the characters. But plotting is important, and figuring out what these characters are going to do is important. Now, there are two schools of thought on what the best way to approach plotting is. And one school likes to outline everything. There are authors who outline what's going to happen in every chapter, and then just kind of fill in that outline as they go along. The other school is the school that I tend to belong to, which is kind of improvisatory. I get an idea of basically what the story is I'm going to tell, and then I just wing it. Because I think that one of the most thrilling moments in any art form that takes place in time is when something happens that takes you utterly by surprise, but in the next instant you realize that it had to happen that way, that there was no other way that it could have turned out. But even though it had to happen that way, the outcome takes you completely by surprise. And the way that I've found that this happens best is if I can take myself by surprise. And that means not really knowing how any chapter is going to turn out. To have the courage to start writing without knowing where you're going. And even if you have a general idea of how everything is going to end, if you don't really know, you can take yourself by surprise, and one of your characters can say something that you suddenly, as you're writing, realize, of course they'd say this here, but I didn't think they would. I wasn't planning on them saying that. But here they are saying that, and now other stuff is going to happen. And this can be a great challenge and a fun challenge for me as a writer, because then I have to figure out what to do. It's like, oh crap, now this character has said this, I can't go back and unsay it. And now I have to respond to it. What is everybody else going to say? Nobody was expecting this. You know, we've just turned the right corner, and I know that the plot is going to end up in this general place, but now I have this new problem to solve. And that comes to basic fact of any story. Any story is basically a problem to solve. Dorothy gets caught up in a tornado and goes to the land of Oz. How is she going to get home? That's her problem. Dorothy wants to go home. She doesn't know how to get home. Frodo is left a magic ring by his uncle. And we find out it's the most evil piece of jewelry ever made. What's he going to do? How are they going to solve this problem? And they go all through Middle Earth just trying to figure out how to solve the problem of the ring and Sauron. And you can take that in any story at all. Death of the Salesman, Willie Loman is trying to, he thinks that his life, that he's worth more dead than he is alive, and he wants to leave his family some money. How is he going to get that to happen? Every story is basically a problem. And when the problem is solved, or when the problem is resolved, then the story is over. So what I'd like to do here is write a story with you guys right here, okay? So first, we need a central character. Who wants to be the central character? Okay, in the blue hair, you're right in the middle. You're central, so you can be the central character, okay? All right, so, what do you do? What does your character do?
Well, my character dances.
You're a dancer. Great, okay. Do you live in a city or outside of a city? So, already, she solved one problem. She's in the city. We could have said, no, she lives like by the North Pole, and the first problem that she has is getting to the dance academy. But that's fine. So we said she lives in the city. Great. Okay. So let's say that it's Monday morning, and you get up, and you want to go to class, right? You want to be a dancer, right? That's the problem, and you want to go to class. All right. Who has a problem? What goes wrong? Why can't you go to class? Yes.
Her transportation breaks.
Her transportation breaks?
Yes.
Great. Okay. What kind of transportation does she have?
Bicycle.
She has a bicycle. Okay, how does it break?
The chain flies off randomly.
The chain breaks. Okay, her bicycle chain breaks. Okay, now we have a problem. All right, so now we need a secondary character. Who wants to be the secondary character? All right, are you in the black hair? Yeah, you're in the black top right. Okay, so you're the secondary character. Okay, and our first character's name is?
Agnes.
Okay, great, as in Agnes. And our secondary character's name is?
Mickey.
Ricky? Ricky? Ricky, okay, great. See, it's not that you're speaking Swedish, it's that I'm old and deaf. So Ricky lives next door to Agnes. All right? First, I'll ask you, Ricky, do you know how to fix bicycles?
Yes.
You do know how to fix bicycles?
I do.
Okay, great.
Built a bicycle.
Great. Okay, so, Agnes, do you know that Ricky knows how to fix bicycles?
No, not yet.
No, all right. So, let's say that you are downstairs and you are standing by your bicycle and the chain is broken. Okay? That's your problem. Ricky knows how to fix bicycles, which may seem to solve our problem right away. But if it does solve our problem, what happens? It's the shortest story in history, right? our story is Agnes comes down, her bicycle chain is broken, Ricky comes out and says, oh, I can fix that, and off she goes. All right, so now we need a secondary problem. How can we keep the problem from being solved? The problem is the broken bicycle chain. Ricky, why can't you immediately fix the bicycle chain? You know how to fix bicycles, you don't have any tools? Right, so Ricky comes down and says, I know how to fix that. And Agnes goes, great. And then what happens? I don't have any tools. Well, why did you stop by to help me fix the bicycle in the first place? Now we have two people arguing, right? Agnes needs to get to her class. It's going to happen in 15 minutes. If she leaves now, she can make it just in time that she has no bicycle chain. And Ricky comes in and wastes her time by saying, I can fix your bicycle. Oops, no, I can't. So, what do we do now? Agnes, what do you do?
I ask if we're his bus card.
No, you have Ricky right here.
Yeah.
So, So you asked Ricky for her bus card?
Yeah.
I see. Ricky, do you need to get to work? Yeah, Ricky needs to get to work too. She has to use her bus card. So now we have a cat fight. So she needs to get to work. She has her bus card. She feels bad that she knows how to fix her bike, and she doesn't have any tools. So what do you do next? Well, she knows how to fix the bike. All we need to do is get some tools, right? Where can we get some tools? Where are your tools? Not with you. Do you have them, or do you not have any tools? You just worked at a bike shop once. The basement, boxes you haven't unpacked. Okay, so 15 minutes, you have to get to dance class. Right, you have to go down to the basement, find which box it's in, and unpack it and get the tools out. So you get to the basement, and what happens? There's the box, and it's marked tools. And you open up the box, and there's nothing in it but dishes. That's a problem, right? We have avoided solving the problem. Our story goes on. Okay, so you open the box, there are the dishes. You take out a dish and say, are you kidding me? I need to get to class. I'm going to audition for the National Ballet tomorrow. I need to get to class today. That makes the problem more urgent, right? If the problem was, I need to get to class, only if I feel like skipping, it doesn't really matter, so I think we're going to watch TV, we got no problem, right? So, you get so mad, you smash one of the dishes. Now, Ricky has a problem. You just smash one of the dishes, like, I offered to help you fix your bicycle, and now you're smashing my dishes. Sorry, I marked the wrong box tool, but I was in a hurry. My uncle died, and I was sad. Well, now Agnes has a problem because she feels bad about bringing up the uncle's death of Ricky. Right? And so now, what is the problem? Right, you have now 12 minutes to get to class.
Oh, yeah.
Should you spend 5 of those minutes consoling Ricky about the death of her uncle? Or not? That's the problem.
Well, he said already dead, there's nothing I can do, so I'm dead.
No wonder Ricky wants to help you. You're such a warm, caring human being. but you see what I mean? So the problem can be anything, is what I'm getting at, right? And all it has to be is, okay, how are we going to take care of this? How are we going to take care of this? And so let's say that, okay, you decide, oh my gosh, I'm sorry. Did your uncle give you that plate? Did your uncle give you that plate? Her uncle gave her that plate. What are you going to do?
I'll pay.
So this irreplaceable family heirloom, what are you going to pay? Kroner, maybe?
Well, whenever
you
become a famous ballerina, I can...
Oh, I see. Later. Okay, great. I see how this story is going now. Okay.
All right. I'm really stressed. My thinking is really stupid right now.
And so finally, Ricky, who is the kindest person in the world, says, don't worry about it. I'll glue the plate back together later. And let's keep looking for the tools. And now we only have 10 minutes because we've wasted another 2 minutes of doing that, okay? The clock is still ticking, right? So, you open up another box that's marked bedding, and lo and behold, there are the bicycle tools. Is our story over?
No.
No. So what's the next problem? Right. You take the tools out of the bicycle. The chain is broken. What's the problem? Okay. No, we found the tools. We can't go back and unfind the tools. Right, so they're the wrong tools. Right, oh, this is not a Swedish bicycle, this is an English bicycle. Oh, my tools don't fit your chain. Okay, so, and at this point, what has happened? Ricky has spent just enough time trying to help Agnes fix her bicycle that what do they see? The bus go by. Now Ricky can't get to work, and Agnes can't get to her class on her bicycle. Now it's become a buddy picture. Now it's Ricky and Agnes against the world. Nobody can get anywhere, right? So, what do they decide to do? Yes?
hijack a car. Hijack a car.
Hijack a car! Okay, great! So now we have a car. Yay! It turns out that the bicycle tools won't fix Angus's bicycle, but they're great for breaking into cars. Okay, so who wants to be our third character? Yes, over there with the gray t-shirt with the glove.
Johannes,
you come out of your apartment and see these two race off in your car.
Who the heck stole my gosh darn car?
Except that it's not even that, because you can see them. Your neighbor and this new kid who works on bicycles is riding off in your car. Okay? What's the problem? Oh, not an interesting enough problem. The problem is, he's really attracted to Agnes. Does he call the cops on her or not? That's a real problem. I want my car back, but I really want to go to bed with Agnes. So now we're in the horns of a dilemma, right? So, what is the secondary problem that makes it even better? It turns out that Agnes and Ricky are both lesbians. And they're kind of striking up in the car, right? So, what's Johan?
Johannes,
right. He doesn't know this. So he's still trying to figure out. So we have two stories going now, right? We have the story of the buddy pick of the two lesbian car thieves trying to get to work and trying to get to dance class. And Johannes is the nicest guy in the world, just the nicest guy, never done anything to anybody, wouldn't hurt a fly, and these two hideous lesbians have stolen his car. Who do we root for? If we root for the lesbians, then we've just written a story for lesbians. Right? And we want this book to sell to everybody. So what we want to do is not be able to figure out who to root for. Every time we think the lesbians are nasty car thieves, we find out something more about them that makes us care about them and want them to succeed. And every time we find out something more about Johannes, we think the last thing this poor guy needed was people to steal his car, and particularly a girl that he cared about and was too shy to come up to, and it's like, he's just such a nice guy and we care about everybody. Now we have a real problem. How do we get these three people to all be pals? Because obviously they all like each other, they're all nice, and you guys just were in a conundrum and had to steal a car, and it was a youthful fit of exuberance. And so, but you see what I'm saying? You don't want to solve the problem. You want to make the problem worse every step you go. Until finally at the end of the story, Johannes fixes your bicycle. You come home from dance class, and there's Johannes fixing your bicycle, and you feel so bad, you realize, and he says, thanks for bringing my car back. Now what's the problem? No, it's a better problem than that. Johannes is fixing your bicycle. He's done... Well, that's one of the problems, right? He's done this nice thing for you, and the way he's looking at you, you know, oh, this guy likes me. What? I'm sorry?
It's an intimate term.
Well, friend zone. Yes, right. It's like friend zone. Right. Well, I mean, we know that that's ultimately going to happen. Right. And that's how the story has to turn out because, you know, lesbians are lesbians. And guys don't have vaginas. But we have this. So I mean, it could be that, you know, you drive the car back and Ricky can take her bus pass home. She gets home. And when you see each other, you know, Ricky comes up and you're talking to Johan and you're kind of uncomfortable because Johan is saying, hey, I fixed your bike and I'm really not mad at you for taking my car, but I hope you ask me first the next time because I just, you know, got fired from my job because I couldn't drive there and he's being really nice. And then Ricky comes up and you guys see each other and you know, the sparks have flown in the car, and you just can't wait to get together now that you're through with dancing and you're through with your job. And what do you do with Johannes? What do you do? That's a problem, isn't it? Say thank you for fixing my bike, but you need to do something nicer than that, right? Been overcompensating for his closeted gayness this whole time. Can't wait to go to the ballet and meet the gay guy. Yay! That's a story. You see, because we have all this tension and we finally resolve it at the end. That's basically the structure of any story at all. So at this point, I guess I'll open it up to questions and see if anybody has anything you want to ask me about.
I want to hear more about Agnes, Ricky, and Johannes.
Right, okay. Well, you know, in book two, of course, they open up this, you know, gay orgy 24 hours a day. And they have a sideline in car stealing and bicycle fixing. It's a very strange book. No, but let's, anyone have any questions? Yes.
Gary Schwartz, all the time.
Oh, yeah, very good friend of his.
He's a nice guy.
Oh, he's a great guy. He's actually even older than we are. I know, it's incredible.
Yeah, Gary Schwartz, for those of you who don't play TF2, is the voice of the Heavy.
Heavy Man, that's right.
And he does this Arnold Schwarzenegger thing. And Gary Schwartz does a wonderful Arnold Schwarzenegger, but Gary actually is this tall, skinny, bald guy. And he looks kind of like Ed Wynn.
And he runs a theater outside of Seattle.
And if you want to see him act, he plays the bald caveman in the film Quest for Fire that came out in the 80s. And it's kind of a wonderful film because they made up a language for the cavemen to speak, so you don't hear any English or Swedish or anything else in the film. It's just a bunch of cavemen running around. But he plays the bald caveman, and he's now the Heavy. And he's a very nice guy.
Gary Schwartz is a great guy. And he's a wonderful actor, and he's a teacher.
And we work with him all the time.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.
I don't play any games. I'm not smart enough.
Ellen plays bridge.
I play bridge. Are there any bridge players here? Yeah, oh my, yeah, bridge.
Yeah. I have played, I love Half-Life 2. I've played that and the episodes. I played TF2 just a little bit because I can't catch up to it. It just.